What we see today still approximates to the creation that Brown would never see. It's sadly inevitable that Stowe's arcing lawn should invite golfers, sartorial cripples who require that the grass be cropped. It shouldn't be. Before the invention of the lawnmower in 1830, the grass would have been controlled merely by scythes and by sheep. It would have looked more natural, a word which has to have inverted commas around it. The house today is largely that which Temple bequeathed in 1779. His motto was Templa quam delecta, how lovely the temples are, and he built more and more of them with an apparent compulsion, a glut that even a park of Stowe's dimensions could not coherently contain. Stowe House is a viewpoint from which to gaze on the wonders of the park. Had glass technology been more advanced, you can be pretty certain that something approximating to picture windows would have been installed. Within the house, little remains that attests to the magnificence with which the Temple Grenvilles flattered themselves. Their identification with the Whig cause was such that their fall was as sudden and as rapid as that of Whiggery itself. From being the richest family in Britain in 1780, they were, by 1830, so riddled with debt that a series of house sales had to be held, culminating in one which lasted 40 days in 1848. Few were killed in the rush to buy a bargain marble bust. Victorian indifference to Georgian taste is suggested by the fact that that sale raised only £75,000. What remains is salutary. It shows that Stowe belonged to an era of supreme decoration, interior decoration and exterior decoration, which is different from belonging to an era of supreme architecture. The house is the largest structure in the park. It is, or should be, the sculptural centerpiece, which rather than adopt the form of a temple or a grotto, adopts the form of a palace. But it's not much of a palace. Whilst the garden front is of a piece, the north front is by half a dozen different hands. As Whigs, the Grenville temples were susceptible to fashions, architectural, agricultural, abolitionist. Fashion depends on hope and on the promise that things will improve merely because they have changed. Oddly, the Grenville temples were consistently loath to discard last year's model. The core of the house is of 1680. It was remodeled three times over the next 100 years in a variety of styles. The gateways to the forecourt, for instance, are Baroque, by the Italian Giacomo Leoni. Beside them, Vanbrugh's portico shows how absurd it is to classify him as a Baroque artist. Save in his great prentice piece, Castle Howard, he wasn't. He was thereafter of no school, or rather of a school which had yet to exist. His work increasingly prefigured the brawny, sodieu neoclassicism of Claude Nicolas Ledoux, made 50 years after he died. Until it began to take its cue from Greek rather than Roman models, there was nothing brawny or sodieu about British neoclassicism. Its most fashionable exponent, Robert Adam, was grudgingly appreciative of Vanbrugh's contrapuntal collisions. He talked of movement in his work. The play of planes, masses, levels, and textures
and the tension between the components of a building. But it was just that, talk. The effects he actually achieved were as insipid and as smoothly reticent as those of the Palladians. Adam's fingerprints are all over the design, even though it was twice altered by Giovanni Borra, and then by Thomas Pitt, the Prime Minister William Pitt's brother, and thus Temple's brother-in-law's brother.
It was no doubt Pitt who decided that the figure of Liberty
should be modelled on the altogether admirable John Wilkes, who wrote,
"Life can then little else supply but a few good..." and then you die.
Maybe the amendments improved it from close to, but from across the lake, where the house is best seen, they make no difference. The south front is very long, but imagination cannot be measured in yards. Despite its length, it cannot disguise the fact that it's off the mid-Georgian country house production line.
The low wings between the three pavilions do not link them. Rather, they extend the composition. They render it centrifugal. It should be concentrated. The components should be integrated.
It is grandiloquent with little to say. It lacks vigour. It lacks go. Most of all, it lacks sublimity. The property Edmund Burke contrasted with beauty. He contended it was associable with a terrible magnificence in nature. This is something which great architecture aspires to incite, intimations of transcendence and mortality. Such buildings were seldom made in the polite hiatus that endured for three quarters of a century after Vanbrugh, when English architecture was all beauty, temperate elegance and gracefulness. Socially admirable qualities, no doubt, but the anaesthetics of art.
Georgian architecture appeals to people who are scared of architecture. It shouts about its restraint. It suppresses emotion in the service of reason. It takes civility to the point where it is desperate not to offend, a quality which is in itself offensive. Georgian architecture is the first refuge of the imaginatively bereft when they wish to demonstrate their good taste.
The case of Capability Brown is telling. His architecture, which he practised prolifically after he left Stowe, was pedestrian at best. His brio deserts him when he has to address the functional. It is as though his landscaping and parks were the creations of a different bit of his brain, of a contrary sensibility, one that throws off the shackles of rationalism and invents without inhibition. His parks were unlike any that had hitherto been seen. Like all great artists, he made his own genre. Stowe repeats the schism which afflicts Brown. The house represents an architecture of such languor that the Victorians, who revered energy and restlessness, considered it idle and decadent.
But the camp temples, the fey hermitages, the bizarre grottos, and above all, the hallucinatory park are thrilling. Age of reason?